to the Trinity Force Podcast. Yo, it's that Triforce cast beaming straight to your home. Grab a beer so we know Pone ain't drinking alone. Send an email, a quick tweet, just pick up the phone. Leave a message, hit the beep if you're a creep, watch your tone. Discuss the meta, game, patch notes, whatever helps your stats most. Obi, Pone, Kenobi is your last hope to snatch gold. So grab your headphones and join in the fun. We'll try enforcing some jokes and some cringeworthy puns. Yo, we can make it together, people. Trinity Force Podcast. These boys are second to none. Now that's the end of the intro. It's time we've begun.
Hey, guys. Welcome, everybody, to the Trinity Force Podcast. My name is Adam Ponophobia Cogswell. I am your host for this awesome evening here as I move away from the microphone to sit up. I am joined by only two guys this evening, one of which is losing his shit.
Two that matter.
Well, you like, that's the drunkest you've sounded doing the intro in a really, really long time.
Hey, guys, I almost fell out of my chair. Punafubia cucks.
God, seriously, I haven't probably been drunk on this show in like 2 years. It's been a while.
I know, and that's why I was laughing so hard there. Just, it was a hearkening to the old times.
Yeah, it's probably a good thing. I've been trying to save my liver. Drink a little less. Be around for the kids and wife. You know.
Makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, I did. Life does change, and always for the better. So everyone's happy. Sean's happy. He's getting over his sickness. He's back to drinking.
Yeah, I've had the plague all weekend. It's not fun.
Which, speaking of drinking, before I get into everything and what we're going to talk about tonight, because we're probably going to need all the time to talk. Earlier today, I tweeted at Skyen. And I said, we'll pay for the meal, you pay for the drinks, we're going to talk about Warwick soon. And no one said anything about making somebody else pay for the drinks for the Trinity Force podcast, which I thought was hilarious. Because I was like, well, the drinks probably could add up to be more than the meal. But everybody went with it. I found that amusing. No one else might.
You overthought it.
Yeah.
No, I just thought it was amusing.
Or maybe there's like surprisingly little intersection between your followers, or I guess the TFN's followers and his followers. Maybe it's just like this two totally different groups of people. Probably not, but maybe.
I mean, we're all League fans, right? I would assume. Well, actually, I assume most League fan drinks. Drink? Most League fans drink.
They're children.
But they're children.
How dare you assume
right.
that?
That's where I was getting at, which the majority of people are 18 to like 24, so... who knows? That's all you lovely people out there listening. Who would like to support us on Patreon? Patreon.com/TForce Network. Go sign up. $25 a month is a replay review. $50 is a coaching session and a replay review. $10 is our Champions Select podcast hosted by Days and Mitch. We have quite a number of them out there for you to listen to. $10 today gets you access to everything. $25 gives you access to everything. Like, it takes it right out of your bank account the moment you sign up. So if you get paid, you have an extra $10, toss it our way. We would love you. Reminder that it does take that money out on the first of every month. So if you sign up on the 30th, you will also get a second $20 charge on the first, assuming the first is the next day. So just keep that in mind if you go to Patreon right now. We have a lot to discuss tonight because last week we only had one episode. We have two this week, and we're going to be discussing tonight. We're going to be following up on the marksman discussion that we had in the previous week because we received a lot of feedback, primarily from YouTube. There was quite a number of people that were commenting there, and we decided that we should probably wrap back around and talk about this feedback that we received from people's thoughts and whatnot.
It's not like the problem went away.
Right.
And right. And I mean, I don't want to, we're probably going to harp on the same pieces we talked about last week, but I really kind of want to drive it home what the problem might be, because I think some people are still confused after that long discussion. And also us having the discussion and me reading all these comments that people were posting gave me a better idea of what actually is the problem. And like I told Dom earlier, like, I don't want to drink the Marksman is bad Kool-Aid, but I am eyeing it just based on some of the feedback and like the thoughts that are going through my head when I think about it, right?
And then I did a deep dive into the numbers and just sort of our underlying issues for what I think the broader issue is, and was surprised just how many things ended up contributing to that. So we'll see if we get there. I want to keep you all in suspense, though.
So
Sean didn't do any work.
He's no, I did. No.
Sean doesn't ever do any work. He just shows up. That's all I want him to do, though, really, honestly.
Yeah,
I get paid just
to show up and harass Adam quietly before and after the show begins and ends.
And loudly during.
Yes, and loudly during.
Oh, hey.
So. Oh, hey.
Oh, hey. All right, let's talk about the listener feedback that we received last week. I'm actually going to go through the majority of it, and we'll start breaking stuff down. What is it? Is it Shakaraz? Is that his name? How do you say it, Dom?
LOL King, yeah. Tailbot. Yeah, I always say Shakaraz.
Okay, it's probably Shakaraz. I don't actually know if it's Iaz or Aaz. It's likely Iaz. He posted an article earlier this week about what he thought was bad with AD carries, and so we're going to go over some of that. But the primary thing that came up when we had listener feedback was that people thought autofill is the issue with marksman right now. And this is where I said I need my soapbox for, because I need to stand on top of it and just scream. Like, I appreciate everybody that's commenting and everybody that's saying these things, but like, autofill is not the reason that marksmen are bad at all. Autofill will never be the reason that anybody is bad, ever. One, there's no statistical evidence to back up the fact that these people are bad, right? Like, nobody's telling us how many people are being autofilled to what. And if you're, and like, the idea is that marksmen are bad because people are getting autofilled to support. And so the supports are bad, making the marksman, the duo marksman, have a tougher time in lane, making it harder for that marksman to play. And if that were the fact, then the enemy marksman that has a good support would be rolling over the game, right? Like, if that was the case, like, you had such a bad support in marksman duo lane, the enemy marksman would roll over the game no matter what. And even a 5-0 in Twitch can't carry the game by himself right now because of a larger majority or a larger number of reasons.
Well, not until a certain point.
It's sort of funny that, like, in you spelling that out, I'm sitting here like, man, this sounds, the people who are really diehard by that almost sound conspiracy theory level passionate about it, trying to find fucking any yes. little thing to fit whatever narrative that they need to convince themselves that ADC is bad right now.
It's not even that. It's people trying to find a reason why we shouldn't have autofill. They're trying to fit their autofill, their anti autofill narrative in any piece that they can, and they're going, well, autofill is this reason, and autofill's bad, and I shouldn't have to play support because it obviously makes the other person bad. Like, you can't do that.
Autofill is never the cause of a problem. It is a symptom of a problem. That being that, supports are not a popular role, so people are going to get autofilled there to keep queue times low. Or if AD carry is so in such a bad spot that people aren't having fun playing it anymore, then in theory, fewer people are going to be queuing up as AD carry. And as a result, more people are going to have to autofill to AD carry. And that is a symptom of the issue. And yes, there's going to be an experience problem there as a result, but that is never the cause of a meta defining problem the way people are trying to say this. And like, that's the reality right now, is that ADCs are in a really tough spot in the current state of the meta.
Yeah, and it goes further than that. Like, if you want a very simple breakdown of what is wrong with the marksman class right now, and even Riot's come out and said, yeah, there are some problems, and we're going to try to fix it. But you have to go back and look at jungle experience, for example. Junglers are able to get to level 3 and 4 too quickly, quicker than solo lanes, quicker than, obviously, the duo lane. And the junglers have no reason to gank any other lane but bottom, because it provides more control over the map through dragon and through the ability to take towers faster. So they have no choice but to come bottom lane, and having that level advantage, even a level 2 advantage on bottom lane, is such a giant spike that can become an issue
for the rest of the phase.
Yeah.
Level 2 gank from a jungler should turn into blown summoners at very least, and if you've blown bot lane summoners, then
you're not trading.
There's a decent chance that your teammates can just bully them out from there, or get kills or whatever. And if not, you can wrap around as soon as you hit level 3 even. You can wrap around and probably kill them there.
Right. In the Kalebot article, he actually had mentioned that dragon was the reason that marksmen are bad right now, which made me laugh, because historically, marksmen have been in the bottom lane, or the duo lane has been in the bottom lane for dragon control. So you can't really cite that dragon is the problem. Now, I think his larger point was that dragon gives a lot of buffs and, you know, makes people on the team more powerful. But again, dragon is just another reason to be down there.
I mean, it's not going to change. It's the same difference that if they switched where Baron Pit and dragon was, top lane would just become bot lane.
Yeah, top lane would be the new duo lane.
Yeah, that's all there is to it. So that's it's not that
this
big
would
of a
be.
Deal.
it could be solved if they added an objective where Rift Herald is that actually had more significance, but I mean, we've talked a few times now about how just irrelevant that thing feels. You don't notice when your opponent has it anymore. You know, they get in and like, oh, that thing was still in the game. And you might feel it if you're the solo laner. And I kind of wish Punch was here. But I feel like in the past he said, I don't notice when I have it. And I don't notice when I'm up against somebody that has it. It's largely insignificant, in at least in the way you're perceiving the buff.
It's a win harder mechanic rather than a... Rather than a calculated use type mechanic, or like how they wanted you to be able to work up your stacks and use the train and lane, which you can do, like if you're mindful of the stacks and you understand how your character trades, you totally can use that. But it's really just more, it's a win harder mechanic. You're already ahead, so you get it, and then you just use it to continue to bully out the laner rather than using it to trade and try to come back or whatever it may be that you need to, you know, use the item for split push better. Then you start forcing an agenda when you make an item that allows you to split push harder, right? That's why we saw ZZ Rot get nerfed, because everybody starts buying it because it just becomes too powerful.
I'm glad, and that thing's got nerfs on the PvE that it sounds like you're gonna get hit live. Friend of the podcast, Sotir, former co-host, he actually weighed in on it, and basically they don't like how people are using it right now. They are using it to stall out lanes and gold jet and like basically get gold and come from it and everything, and it is not going to be doing that as well. It's basically, they want it to be an item that tanks can buy so that they can, you know, actually split push, because there are a lot of scenarios where they have to deal with split pushers but they can't do it themselves, so it gives them a response there. And I'm pleased with that. I'm really tired of seeing that item show up and just stalling out games and becoming more of a nuisance than anything else. And people think it's good. People think it's a good, like, that's the best way and that they should be doing that all the time, and it's just infuriating.
But, I mean, it is good, right? Like, that's how you should use the item right now. It should be used to stall out a lane. You should buy it to stall out lanes. Now, to say that the item
I don't know if that's a good strategy.
In the state like, is of that, the is game, that winning fantastic.
Is that winning you the game?
Yes, in some scenarios it is absolutely winning you the game, or it stalls enough that you can turn around. I know. I mean, last night we
just easily end up stalling the lane so that your opponent has a push going more in their favor because you foolishly used ZZ Rot the way you did.
No, the problem comes that you can't get that side lane pushing, so you can't. Like, you'll use it on the opposite side of the map that you're trying to siege, right? And you want that. You want to stall that lane so it's always pushing, so someone always has to be up there dealing with it. So rather than that fifth man being up top, ZZ Rot's there to do it. It's like it's a fantastic strategy, but is it healthy?
No, it's a good one in theory, but it's not.
No.
Always utilized the way that it optimally could be.
The point I'm trying to get to is it's not healthy. It's not a healthy state of the game. Like, I'm arguing that it is a fantastic strategy in the state of the game now, but it's just not healthy gameplay for anybody to play into.
I like it in theory. I don't like the way it's being used right now.
All right. I guess
like the way it's being used now more so than when it was being bought on top support and junglers every time it could be. So
anyway, we were not going into this planet to talk about ZZ Rot.
No,
sorry,
no,
everybody.
No.
The other argument that I did see is that people aren't used to adjusting their picks to change, which I guess is another decent theory, and I like that one better than the theory that autofill is the reason, right? Because, yeah, potentially, I mean, I know Varus is really good. Varus is actually pretty good right now.
Third winningest.
Yeah, Urgot, Corki. I mean, Corki still has to use that mid-game power spike to go anywhere, or he just falls flat on his face, right? Or he has to use his early and mid-game power spike, or he just falls completely off the face of the map. But it was kind of one of those where there's no way to really back up that argument either, because Caitlyn is actually doing really, really well right now. She's got about a 52.9% win rate or 53% win rate, and Twitch has just a little bit higher. Yeah, and Twitch got a 53% win rate, right? Yeah. So in the face of all these changes, 52. Jin has like a 50.5 to 51% win rate.
I mean, so you can't exactly use win rates as a determiner in these arguments, because most games still have 80 carries on both teams. So most games are still going to have 280 carries where one's going to win and one is going to lose.
If both of them were the worst character in the game, sure. One of them is still going to win.
So Lucian, you can say Lucian is in a really bad spot because he has a play rate of 11.61% in Plat Plus MMR, and he has a 44.84% win rate. Like, that is very, very problem. When that many people are picking the champion and are unable to succeed with him. You know, if he was hovering around like 48, 49, I'm like, okay, that's fine. He's a widely played champion. It makes sense that he's low. And at the same time, Caitlyn being at a 30.07% play rate in Plat Plus MMR and being the second winningest champion of that class, that's very, very problematic. That says that champion is way, way overpowered, and 80 carry mains, hey, time for you to start playing Caitlyn if you're not already. Or Banner.
I don't think you should ban Caitlyn. You probably shouldn't ban any 80 carry right now. I'm still okay with the Vayne ban, to be honest with you, but I just don't like it. It's like, it may be personal preference. I don't like dealing with the tumble interaction in R, right? Mm-hmm. I don't mind Twitch, though. Like, I see Twitch, and Twitch, I think Twitch can be very feast or famine when it comes to bottom lane. So, for the most part, I agree with you. I think there's one champion, and I don't like her, so I ban her. I ban her not all the time. Usually, she's banned in the games I play. So, I think it's also harder, though, because, like, I think Marksman, I don't want to say there's a lot more skill. It's a really bad way to put it, because that's not true at all. There's a lot of skill. There's a lot of finesse. A lot of finesse that goes into playing a marksman.
There's a lot of knowing. There's a lot of stuff you need to know how to do really right to make things go as well as you can make them go.
Yeah, and that's why I'm saying, like, Caitlyn and Twitch, they're actually pretty hard marksmen to play. Like, congratulations, you're doing fantastic in the hands of skilled players, because Plat Plus, technically, you're a skilled player. But, like, anybody else who's playing Caitlyn might not have the understanding to make her work that well.
Are we not fully appreciating what the old Aegis of the Legion and Locket were doing for us? I mean, you see so many... We like to think that it's because there are tanks, which the ADCs are going to be, you know, shooting the most because they're the closest and they're having the hardest time killing. And then the bruiser divers who can kind of get to the back line and in a lot of cases just annihilate an AD carry. But there are plenty of highlight videos out there of Syndra specifically, and she's getting nerfed. But, you know, Syndra just wiping an AD carry off of the map simply because she pressed R and could do that. Are we not fully appreciating what Locket was actually doing? And I mean the aura part of it, not the active shield, the aura part.
I can't really disagree.
Because removing that from the game made every single mage better. Like, unquestionably.
Yes, because, I mean, that item back in its awesome iteration was somebody had to buy it. Like, every game, that was, you know, you decide for the most part whether somebody's buying it.
Well, and you didn't decide. It was the support bought Locket.
Yes.
It bought Aegis.
And then sometimes you even had two people even further back buy, like, you had jungler and support buy one.
Yeah, way back in the day.
Yeah, way back. Yes, I mean, anything like that is going to, any free stats an ADC is going to get just from somebody standing around them, providing them an aura, is going to be way more beneficial than never having that ever again. But
I mean, just looking at the win percentages from Champion GG for mid lane, and the only champion that I feel like wouldn't have positively been affected by this was Kayle, because Kayle was shredding through resistances so much anyway that it, you know, I feel like Locket and old Aegis were pretty negligible as far as she was concerned. But, you know, the top 15 champions are all ability power. You have to get down to 16 where Jace comes in play. And then the next, five champions are all ability power again.
If that's the case, ADCs can get, if they really wanted to, and yes, if you're talking about their itemization is kind of a pain in the ass, and that if they lose out on certain buys or whatnot, they're going to get more behind. But there are items in the game to help them from just getting insta-gibbed by things like that, such as Hex Drinker. And maybe we've hit this point where we cannot go the standard ADC. Like, this is the rote build that everybody goes because, you know, that's what we've always done.
then in and of itself is a problem because you have to invest all the
you invest $1,400 into it.
One of the arguments that I do agree with is that ADC itemization is too expensive compared to tank itemization. We talked about that last week. We definitely hit that point. We talked about how all the stats.
Maybe even compared to mage itemization right now.
Yeah,
that's always been the case. That's what I was really worried about. Actually, the Mordekaiser changes way back when, and at Worlds that patch, he was ban worthy because mage itemization was so friendly that he was hitting his power spike so much earlier and just crushing stuff. And then they nerfed Mordekaiser.
He was hitting his power spike so much earlier, and he was getting a giant level advantage so much earlier.
Because,
so
it was I'll pull it up, but like a needlessly large rod is so much cheaper than a BF sword.
Needlessly large rod is 1250.
Yeah, 1250, and a BF sword is what, 1400, 1300?
1300.
Was it always?
No, needlessly large rod is more expensive back then. It used to be 1600.
Yeah, but I think they had nerfed the cost of it or something. I don't know. I was really worried about that.
He was powerful because he got a ton of free stats.
5.13 was when they changed when they nerfed the item cost from 1600 down to 1250. And that was before Mordekaiser got changed to that duo lane, not marksman thing they were going for.
Well, the point to swing back to it is I this is not specifically to Sean, but to Sean's point where maybe the Hexstriker is the build. Like, that in itself is a problem if I have to.
No, if you have to build it and your enemy laner doesn't have to, then you just basically lost the lane.
You've lost gold.
Purely to that.
Yeah,
I mean, you've lost a bunch of shit for it.
Yeah, you're spending this extra gold on stats that are, they could help quite a bit, but they also could be fairly negligible because your mid laner could be so far ahead. Like, you're spending all that extra gold. You might as well try to pump out as much damage as you can do and not get hit by the Syndra R. Like, Syndra's probably the only champion.
You're buying this thing as a hope. As just of a hope that it'll help, and then if they're so ahead that it doesn't help, you're way farther behind too, so that's an issue.
Syndra's not the only champion. Syndra's the only champion that's got a point and click kill you, right? Like, there's no counterplay to that. The only counterplay is don't stand near Syndra, and that's really fucking tough to do sometimes because Syndra can just walk through the enemy team. And I think that goes back to the supports that are being played right now. Like, it's because of Redemption that we see all of these. Well, enchanter supports or mage supports that we have out, and itemization not being in the favorite. But I think just that the game's evolved past the point of allowing those. I say it, Leona's Alistar. Alistar's in a bad spot because of other reasons, but still.
You've done a nice segue here because Redemption is. It's the new Aegis. It's the new Aegis. Like, it doesn't matter what support champion you're playing anymore. You just get Redemption because the heal is too big. The damage bonus is
huge.
Like, hey, that's nice. It's nice if you get all that extra damage. And I hope I said it on a previous show, but there was one time I, through Redemption, dealt more true damage than the Twitch on my team. Just through using Redemption well alone on the within team fights. I mean, that's utterly insane. But it's the must-buy item at this point because it's too good.
Well, yeah, it's too good. Anybody needs to buy it. You're playing Braum, you need to buy it, right? Because what Redemption has done by coming into the game has actually made, like, Frozen Heart obsolete because shields are more powerful than reducing the stats of the enemy team. So reducing attack speed of the enemy team isn't as powerful as giving your team a shield and a heal. Of any type. Like, just having that heal right there where it's healing based on percentage of, percent, I think it's percentage of max life, right? Dom? I'm
looking at you. I think the heal is flat, the damage dealt is based on percentage
that's
of flat
it,
life.
Right.
I mean, that's another trend, though, where there are so many abilities and there's so many bonuses tied in with items as well that is just based on whatever your maximum health is, too, so that defensive stats doesn't play into that as much, I guess.
There was a really funny Reddit post the other day. Someone was saying, I didn't realize how difficult support was. He got auto-filled into it, and he's like, oh, it's fine. It's support. I'll play it, whatever. And then suddenly discovered, oh, no, holy shit. I have 4 active items that I have to worry about using. You know, if you're getting Redemption, you've
have
got
fun with 9 abilities.
Sightstone, Redemption, Face of the Mountain, and then probably Mikhail's. You know, something along those lines. Like, you have to worry about so many fucking extra items.
Aegis the Legion. Lock it. rather.
Yeah, or lock it.
100% for sure. Like if.
Yeah, no, that's a good point. I don't know why I blanked on it, but lock it is the one you're getting.
Right. I was talking to Corey about it. Dark Rinku. I can never say your name. He's gonna laugh when he hears that. Dark. I was talking to Dark about it, right? And he was building Frozen Heart stuff on Braum, and he asked me to go over his. He said, "Go over my OPGG. Let me know what I should change." And I basically said, "You know what you need to do? You need to build your Sight Stone. You need to build your Face of the Mountain. And you need to build Redemption." And he's like, "Well, why? Frozen Heart's doing well." I'm like, "Because your job now, even as Braum and any support, is to just mitigate all the damage that you can up front, and then let your AD carry clean up after the fact, or your tanks, or whomever you know is, or your bruisers, whoever it is. You just want to mitigate all that damage up front, and then worry about killing them after the fact. You're not going in these long, these super prolonged team fights anymore, where Frozen Heart's making the difference. It's all them shields and all them heals and whatnot you can drop down. And Braum doesn't have any shields, but you do through Redemption, Face of the Mountain, Aegis, or Locket of the Iron Solari, etc."
And that specific reason is why taking Sion out of the equation, Janna, Sona, Soraka, and Taric are your top, are the winning supports, and then you're still going to see Nami, Karma, and Lulu doing well in most cases and everything. Morgana's even... Morgana's at a 12% play rate in high MMR. Damn. Morgana's right benefiting now from all that stuff. I should play her again. I was really down on her, but maybe
There are so... It's kind of like that thing where, like, you see the Syndras and stuff, and the shield does pretty well about stopping all that burst, and there's so much CC and movement impairments that Morgana's doing really well right now.
Yeah, I'll take another look at her then. I didn't crunch numbers for her today, and I guess I should
have.
Plus,
she's harassy as fucking lane, which is great.
Yeah. I mean, at this point, though, like the highest win or the winningest masteries are still running Wind Speakers, which is just so good. And that kind of gets into the other point I was going to touch on, but I don't want to kind of jump the gun on Redemption and tank supports here.
Yeah, we're moving around. We're 30 minutes into it.
So I, in looking at this, was trying to figure out, I really think there's a thing, I'm calling it shield creep, that's going on here. And there's just
for everyone.
Well, there's that, but we've also radically increased the strength of shields. It is pretty easy for any of these enchanter supports to get plus 50% shielding and healing power. They're all going to get 10% from Windspeaker's Blessing, and that doesn't even account for the bonus armor and MR that they're getting by applying those shields. Arden Sensor and Redemption also both have 10%. You might not get Arden Sensor every game, but you're definitely getting Redemption. And then Mikhail's has 20%. And I said last week that Mikhail's is criminally underpurchased for what it's doing. And that's part of the reason. Like, it makes your shield so strong. But let's pretend for a second you're getting all, you get the 50% bump from your abilities. You're getting the 50% bump to shielding and healing power from all these items and masteries. That is going to bump Locket of the Iron Solari's max shield strength from 665 to 997.5. You're blocking 1,000 damage.
That's quite a bit.
Just from activating Locket. Karma's shield goes from 190 to 285, and then if you empower it with Mantra, it goes from 430 to 645. All these shields and plus shield and heal power things, they stack additively, not multiplicatively, which would even be crazier, but it says unique passive on that stuff. That just means you can't buy for Arden Sensor, so you can get the ability power along with it, and then get shielding and healing power from it.
Wow, 645 is essentially half to three quarters of a Caitlyn headshot, which is...
It's an insane amount of damage. You know, Soraka's normal heal goes from 200 to 300, and then her ult goes from 350 to 525. Janna's standard shield gets up to 360 strength. And then her monsoon is healing 300 HP per second, as long as people are standing in it. Like, do not underestimate the amount of healing and shield, or like more specifically, the shielding that is going on by virtue of this increase. Then there's Courage of the Colossus, which we've talked about ad nauseum. And then I decided to dive into the champions just to see if there's been shield creep in kits. Only two of the newest champions, two of the champions released in 2016 had shields in their kits, but three of the last five visual and gameplay updates added shields to kits that previously didn't have them. Taric and Poppy got shields. Shen had a shield, but they gave him a much much better one and a much more accessible shield at this point in time. York got heals instead of a shield, and Ryze always had a shield in his kit. There are a lot of fucking shields always in the game all of a sudden. And that is why I'm starting to think shield creep is a bigger issue towards the marksman stuff, because if you're getting one shot by a mage, you're getting one shot by a mage. Mages always should have been doing that to you anyway, when it really comes down to it. But they can't kill tanks anymore because they can't get through.
They can't break through the shield.
They can't break through the shield. And like God, I said last week, there are a lot of cases where it's like the support is just better off throwing the shield or the heals on the tank because the enemy marksman is not going to kill him. So all of a sudden you have this murderous juggernaut like just straight running down your throat, and there's not a goddamn thing you can do about it. And what is it? Like there's a cooldown cost that you have to pay. Like if Vayne has to use Condemn on a tank and can't even do anything because that tank has a big fucking shield on them, that's a bunch of time that Vayne has wasted. I mean, marksmen are just kind of in a position where they're not dealing enough damage quick enough to the threats that are coming at them anymore. And so, people don't have to be afraid of marksmen, and they figured that out.
See, I think Vayne is the only outlier here because she's doing percent life, or she's doing true damage through her W, right?
Yeah, but it's not like true damage is ignoring the shield. It's dealing full damage to the shield, but she still has to chunk through the shield before she can do anything.
Sure. Yeah, we've always talked about...
Not that I'm advocating for Vayne, but I'm just saying, I'm not saying poor Vayne, because fuck Vayne, but, it's not... I really don't think she's much better off than anybody else here.
Well, we've always talked about how many auto attacks you get off in a team fight, really, anyway. And if we're still going...
And now
by
if your auto attacks don't count...
Yeah, that's where I'm getting at. If we're still doing the 3-4 auto attack rule before you really have to reposition yourself to get more off... If you're not chunking somebody down to at least half or three quarters through that, your time is wasted. I think this actually circles back around to the point of, is it okay for marksmen to be weak early and mid game if they have such a late game power spike? But if we have such a big creep that is coming through with shields and the amount of life that people are getting in the mid and early game, is it at the point where we keep that, what does Riot do, right? Does Riot start nerfing the early and mid game of all these champions that get all these resistances and all this life and all this shields and shit? Or do they start tweaking the items and making marksmen better?
So in the past, the solution to this was really to just play marksmen that had like really strong mid games. If you remember season 2 and what was basically the Corki Ezreal Graves meta, that's because
Holy Trinity.
Teams weren't trying to stall out games, even though ironically we have one of the longest games on record, with the CLG EU versus World Elite. So we have that during this time, but people were just like, why would I play a champion that gets good by 35 minutes if I can just win in 25? And it's hard to argue with that logic. The problem is that fewer and fewer marksmen are even capable of doing that. If Graves was the old standby for that, he's been nerfed. I mean, he's not... I don't want to say he's not playable out of bottom lane, but he's a jungler at this point. He doesn't show up in champion.gg's stats for that and everything. And, it's hard to do a lot of shit in bot lane with Graves, Quinn gets punished too heavily by her opponents to actually be able to succeed, even though she would be, in theory, a good candidate for that. Her range ends up killing her. So you can't... there aren't any good candidates for to have that good mid-game power spike.
Sorry, I had to walk away. I had to turn off the heater upstairs. People are going to freeze. But I stand right... My computer happens to be right behind the heater downstairs, so I didn't want you guys to hear too much.
Oh, you missed some good points. Actually, we couldn't hear it at all. Or I couldn't hear it. I don't know.
I didn't hear a thing.
Nah, it gets picked up, but,
No, but okay, so do you really feel like there are many mid-game capable marksmen? Because in the past, in season 2, definitely when this was an issue, when people were just like, let's just win in 25 minutes instead of letting the marksmen get fed, sure, their response was playing Corki, Ezreal, or Graves.
I mean, I'm still in games now that if a Caitlyn gets 4 kills in the first 15 minutes, she's carrying the game by 28 minutes. So, that kind of flies in the face of all of the crying that's happening anyway. But I think that's pretty solid for a lot of champions, that if you can get a lead early...
But that's, it's also kind of anecdotal. I mean, like you can't go into a game assuming you're going to get that many kills.
Right. No, and I don't think you should assume that, but it still happens.
No.
And that still swings games.
I think, yes, like Corki, right? Corki's still, I think, really good out of mid lane right now.
Most definitely.
And he can still carry he can carry really hard.
He's the winningest mid laner. Is he really?
I honestly didn't even look. He's fantastic in a mid game because he's got that mixed damage. He's a solo laner, right? Like, I think he put some of these marksmen in a solo lane into a favorable matchup. Yeah, they're going to carry pretty hard, but there's still this lull with some of these, like, these champions, kind of like the... If you're not a spell slinger, essentially, if you're not Jhin where you're bringing some kind of CC to the game, you're not going to do that. You're not doing as great. Yeah, if you're Caitlyn in a solo lane, right, you're better off being babysat and get those extra free stats through dragons and the maybe any extra farm and gold that you receive because you come online at a certain point, then you can't be shut off. But if you're playing in the mid game and you can't guarantee, well, you're not ever guaranteeing, but if you can't increase your chances to gain those extra stats, then you're never... You don't get a point to come online like you would out of bottom lane, right? Like, that's why you're being babysat, because you're just slowly gaining all this gold to the point where it's so much that you are now spiked really heavily and hard into your percentage chance of winning the game. Mid lane, you're just banking that you're going to be able to push the enemy mid laner out, keep it down, and kill the tower if you're playing like Caitlyn mid lane, right? Like, your goal is to win early and hard early, and if you don't do that, there's no fallback where you're able to just sit and farm like you can in a duel lane.
Right.
I mean, that surprises me that, like, we're not seeing more Tristana, and we're not seeing her do better.
What, out of bottom lane?
Well, just, like, if that's your attitude, just take the tower and then, like, prevent the opponent from even having a fallback. Like, Tristana's going to do that really well. She pushes the lane pretty naturally the way it is, but then she has abilities that can do a lot of damage to turrets.
That would be better if junglers couldn't come and gank you or weren't spending so much time in that side of the map, right? Like,
putting this all together, it really seems like the level disadvantage that bot lane has with the level advantage that jungle has obtained is still going to be way more of the issue than anything else that we're almost running into at this point.
So,
like, that disparity seems so significant.
Should supports be running experience runes to make up for that in some way? Like, if we are too...
What do supports get out of it?
Another level. Experience. And so all of a sudden, you know, you're ganking, and now one of those opponents that you're ganking is at the same level as you, and you no longer have this level disparity that you have been hinging on. Now, in theory, let's assume the opponent's support is still doing that. That's still making you double, like, rethink the decisions that you were about to make, and maybe it's easier to just go and try and gank the mid laner.
Probably not, because a support really only needs level 3 to be able to do anything, you know, to be able to stop anything. Like,
yeah, but that's, I mean, we're saying that
hopefully
the bottom lane is getting ganked at level 2 when the support doesn't have that.
I think that comes around to the fact that you're just assuming that something's going to happen in the first 3 levels. So you're investing runes assuming that something's going to happen.
You have played enough games this season to know that something is probably happening in the first 3 levels.
Sure. And yeah, you are investing a ton of money.
Investing
a ton of money in just in a large assumption. Now, yes, that can happen, but you would have to go crunch some hard numbers to see if that is actually, if you are actually hitting at any point a level ahead of anybody by running experience runes. I don't think the amount of tank that you're giving up for the extra life that you're receiving
say,
by
if,
getting
if,
extra
if,
levels.
If you're giving up. If you're going to want to look into how much mitigation you're actually getting per point in comparison to that quarter of a level of difference that you're getting in the small amount of time that the game's going on.
Move speed, which I don't want to give up.
So. Okay.
So then why even bring it up?
Dom? Yeah.
Because
why make me think you would get rid of your move speed?
Because the argument then, or what the argument was coming to, is the fact that the duo lane is at an experience disadvantage, and if they're at an experience disadvantage, a solution to that is experience runes.
I think it's because we're not Riot.
We don't get to make decisions.
Right.
We don't get to make Riot level decisions and actually just change the game to work better for us. We have to work with what's available, and experience runes are available. I don't think it's the way to go, but you have to at least have it in the conversation
right,
at this
right.
point, because you know, the experience is the issue. I made him get a beer.
Yeah, yeah, you did.
I drove him to drink. Dom.
I've had a beer. I went and got another one. I'm drinking Coors. Because I wanted
killing werewolves.
I wanted something that don't make me drunk. Don't make me. I can speak good. Living that southern life, boys. Actually, that'd be more like the Midwestern life, but.
Yep.
The good old Coors.
I mean, you are from Kentucky, so you like to pretend you're in the South.
I'm close enough to it.
Hashtag Kentucky fought for the North.
Thanks, Sean. I'll be honest, that the whole Marksman Redemption Tank shield creep conversation, I really expected that to last a bit longer than 40 minutes. Too.
Well, I mean, I guess the reality is we don't have solutions.
No, I wanted to bring it up to people.
People's arguments, like the auto fill thing, I just don't agree with. I don't think that's what's causing. That's a symptom of a broader issue.
Adam, as somebody who's playing ADC a lot right now, what are you doing, if anything, to combat not being as strong early in compared to the past? Is there anything that you're doing differently? Have you adapted to any changes in the game in order to put yourself in a more advantageous position to win games?
I just try to impart my will on the game. You can ask Dom. I push all fucking day, and I just rely on my ability to flash or dodge skill shots to, you know, make bottom lane a safe place for me to be.
So what you're saying is you're just banking on being better than the other person.
Yeah,
and that's
At a certain point, you have to stop blaming external factors and start holding yourself accountable.
That's true. I agree with that.
I realize that like my strategy to play bottom lane doesn't go for everybody, right? Like I realize that me pushing and dodging that Vi Q or whatever it may be.
And it can be really frustrating for people that are playing with you too, which is beautiful, but...
And it's frustrating to play into that. Like I'm banking on the enemy jungler being in my lane. Like I'm not complaining about this. As much as we're talking about this, I have never complained.
I wouldn't say you should complain about it. I put myself in that situation.
Yeah, I put myself in that situation, right? And that's the thing. Like I put myself in a situation. But like if I'm in a spot where I am being ganked prior to me pushing and expecting the gank and I'm dying a lot, I'm just standing back and trying to equal out the lane and play safe. Like that's a big thing with marksmen that I don't see a lot of lower level marksmen do, is try to equal out the lane. They don't match auto attack for auto attack. They don't try to, and the supports don't help either. A lot of supports won't help you try to push back and try to match the lane. Like at some point, assuming that the enemy isn't smart enough to stall the lane out and they just want to push into you, you have to match auto attack for auto attack and try to keep up on farm as best you can and just pray to God that that Nocturne comes bottom lane and ganks for you, right? Otherwise, you just sit down there and you just hope you can outplay them at some point.
As a support, there's nothing more infuriating than the AD carry who doesn't understand that by pushing all the way to the enemy turret and then keeping them pushed means we're putting a big fucking target on our heads, and you have to watch the minimap and be prepared to move. Like, don't go for that one last CS, or don't go for one harass or whatever it is you think that you should be doing, because like when that jungler comes flying in, you gotta be ready to fucking move, and like nothing else matters at that point, because otherwise we're dying. I mean,
it's the same thing with jungling right now. I know, you know how we've discussed in the past that if you're farming a camp and there's somebody that's close enough to you to go help, you need to just leave that camp and go help them right now.
Yeah.
That has never been more true than what it is right now with the level advantage that it is, because if it goes even farther that when junglers can get other people behind or when they can get themselves more ahead, there are times as a jungler where I can be a solid two levels, maybe even three, above somebody else in the game if I can really push the pace. Like as a jungler, I've been able to hit level 18 before other people, and this is different for me this season because this isn't like something that I've gotten to see as often, having the experience disadvantage that we've had in the jungle in the past. So like I think a lot of it still has to do with the jungle XP. I think, again, it's going to.
And they're nerfing that in
right, and they should. They probably should have like a couple weeks ago. But
you could argue this was a fun experiment.
This was a fun experiment. I've enjoyed it while I've been able to take advantage of it. It's great to be able to hit level 6 on Nocturne before bottom lane's level 5.
I saw your face, Adam.
I didn't do anything. I don't know.
You had some slow blinking and eye rolling going on there.
I really didn't, but you can say I did.
Oh, man, that was good.
you can think I did, but that didn't happen, Dom.
Yeah, just like you hit all those Ziggs abilities.
Ooh. I hit all of them. There's video proof.
Uh-huh. Yeah, no, there's video.
We have video lies.
There's video proof of every single one being hit.
Every failure that's ever accumulated.
At least I'm not the canceler of League of Legends.
All right, man.
I love that video. That thing. Seriously, go watch the Cheer Jaden Plays Camille video highlights.
Yeah, we need more of those. We really do need to get together. I just wish we weren't all sick. Like I've been fucking sick for like a week, and then Sean gets it right after me. I didn't even see Sean.
I haven't seen Sean
in like a year.
We played, humorously enough, we played one game yesterday. We sit in queue. We get into a game. We're picking stuff. Somebody dodges. Immediate queue pops, and I get auto-filled to AD carry.
Yeah, and
what a time to be alive,
top
boys.
Jungle.
Adam,
what were you then?
He got placed in jungle, and he queued for what?
Mid-jungle.
Mid-jungle, all
right. Oh, so you weren't queued for anything. Yeah, okay, that makes more sense.
I mean, we ended up just trading anyway, but...
Yeah, right. I'm like, all right, well, Sean, I'll just take bot, I guess. Right?
that makes sense.
That was so funny.
Well, that was going to bring me back. That game was going to actually kind of bring me back to the ZZ Rot discussion, since we weren't really going to talk about it, but maybe we'll wrap back around to it for just a moment. Where, granted, we were super fucking far ahead that entire game. Like, Sean was 15 and something at one point, right?
I was fucking enormous. Yeah, there was a point where I just ran past two people, killed Zyra, ran away, Adam showed up, and we just turned and killed everybody else. It was just us two.
Oh, I need to clip that one. Yeah, I need to clip that from plays. I also need to clip the funny thing that I told Dom that I was going to clip earlier, where I foobarred my order.
What a real treat for the listeners there.
Right. Though they can see it. They follow me on Twitter. They'll be able to see it. They'll see my Caitlyn foobar. I remember me laughing about it. I said that. I'll just tell it because fucking no, I forget we have.
No, Adam, you got to keep people in suspense. What are you doing?
I queued my E up and I flashed, but I moved my mouse back over to where I was at to ready to auto attack.
So you flashed away and E'd right back in?
I flashed away and E'd right back into the same spot that I flashed out of.
And you're an AD carry, mate.
And I fucking died laughing. I just let myself die. As soon as I went there, I was
Diamond
like, I'm
five
dead.
Mechanics, ladies and gentlemen.
It made me laugh. No, okay, to go back to that game. They bought a ZZ Rot, right? And it was actually, we were ahead. I was sitting like 7-something or 10-something, and Sean's 15, and it's still pretty infuriating to try to push into a tower when there's every half a second, it feels like, a ZZ Rot minion spawns. And they don't have to move. They move really quickly. And they're decently tanky enough where they can't push you can't get the wave into the tower as quickly as you want it to, and it gives just enough time for the enemy team to make it there and push back, or the enemy wave to make it there and push back. Like ZZ Rot in that case was pretty infuriating to play against.
Yeah,
now,
that's the majority of the cases that I see it being used, and that's why it's infuriating. Like
you are playing correctly.
You are taking something and using it in a different way than it was intended, because and it would be scrub mentality to do otherwise. That doesn't mean I still think it's infuriating.
To add insult to injury, it was built on a Teemo who, by the end of the game, his next biggest item finished was a Sheen.
Well, that Teemo did get the shit all over. Just like,
oh, I camped the fuck out of him.
They're also changing it so that Nasus can, or so that it no longer counts for CS, which I take to mean that Nasus can no longer stack his Q off of ZZ Rot minions.
I'm looking at that game too, and out of the jungle, I was the second highest level person in the game. The Darius, who I got really fed, was level 15. We ended the game at level 14, and I was 4 levels ahead of their support, 3 levels ahead of their AD carry. and two levels ahead of everybody else.
Yeah, well, granted, you also had jungler. 15 or 20 kills by the time
but
the game ended,
I mean, that's great, but, like, still jungler.
Still a jungler, still jungler. That stopped jungling at a certain point. Champion. It just started farming people. Like, you can't... that is such, that's such anecdotal evidence about how
you're
much
you're
right.
I ended up 15-3. I apologize.
I guess this wasn't on the document. I didn't put it in there. I meant to talk. I wanted to talk about it maybe on Wednesday, but we'll do it today right now. It's kind of like talking about being a little bit about being gun shy. I know I'm throwing this guys on you, but I've been playing a lot of flex queue recently because I like to play with everybody here. And I just believe that flex queue is the best place to just jump in there. And I've been playing against a very wide variety of players, but for the most part, a lot of the players are actually like earlier. Late bronze. You want to call it late? Is it late if you say bronze one? That'd be late bronze, right?
High. That's high bronze.
Yeah, I guess I'll just use the high is better than late. But yeah, like I'm playing against a lot of high bronze, mid tier silver, maybe low gold, like you know that kind of like area. Like every once in a while, you get the platinum in there.
Been enjoying it.
Well, I've been enjoying it because I've actually been enjoying playing with everybody. Really, honestly, yeah. I've also been enjoying playing and seeing some of the really bad players that have been playing too. But I kind of feel like there's this weird... We've talked about it in the past, how to be better and how to play better, but there's this weird phenomenon that I see with players that sit in silver and bronze, and that's a lot of them are very gun-shy. They sit on the... like. Well, I'm going to use Nocturne, for example. He's probably the outlier here because he has his ultimate to get into a fight at any point in time, but... No, the Shaco did it the other day, too. I think Dom and I were playing.
Shaco?
Yeah, I had a Nocturne that did something very similar, where they stand on the outside of the team fight. Now, if I was playing with a higher-level player, they would make the decision to come into that skirmish in bottom lane at some point, like an early point. Like, you're standing there, we're going to start a skirmish because you're going to start walking around. But they kind of stand off to the sides and wait to see how it goes, and they're afraid to jump into the fight. It's I don't know if it's indecisiveness or just they're gun shy because they don't want to die or whatever it is, but I feel like there's a trend, and I see it more than just with the skirmishes of bottom lane. I see it with engaging and whatnot. We talk a lot about you should just engage team fights, but a lot of people I think are afraid to make the move, maybe because they've been twice bitten, once shy type of thing.
Once bitten, twice shy.
Thank you. Once bitten, twice shy.
It's the same. The same kind of thing where if. Let's look at people who play Riven into people who aren't used to playing Riven, and that Riven just crushes you three or four times in lane. You'll never want to look at that Riven
punch.
In the face. Yeah, there you go. Punch. The Punch never wants to fight another Riven ever again in his whole life.
Punch 11.
Because of that. But instead of it just being Riven specific, it's maybe... And maybe, you know what, maybe this is a bigger question to the community as a whole and people just being dicks to one another when somebody makes a mistake and dies. Maybe at a lower level in this game, somebody getting smacked down verbally or doing it themselves and getting smacked down verbally or whatever has kind of like reached this point where now people are too afraid to do anything because they're more afraid to make a mistake than they are to take a chance.
See, it's funny you say that because I almost run into the opposite issue more, where it's people do not have any measure with their aggression. It's at level
one. Oh, you mean whale?
Yeah, but not whale is like kind of a weird isolated case where it works for him. I'm talking about the people who go into the game and act like they are level 18 and that they have all of the items and cooldown reduction and access to all their abilities right off the bat, and that and they have no respect for their opponents irrespective of the stage of the game that it's at. You know, they just go in thinking they are the best and they get utterly punished for it, but that doesn't cause them to remotely take their foot off the gas pedal. They just keep going, and then they don't understand why they're so far behind or why they're fed, or they blame the jungler.
I mean, honestly, though,
or the mid laner or whatever.
That could very well just be two sides of the same coin.
Yeah, I mean, I think
it's the extreme in
I think it's lack of
all of the idioms tonight.
I think it's lack of discipline on in both cases and everything, and that's what you encounter in lower MMR more than anything else. Like you can harp on mechanics and positioning and all that stuff is important. I don't want to like betray what we've been saying in the past, but at a certain point, fucking understand when you are strong and when you are not strong and start making some of your and also when your opponent is strong and when they're not strong, and start making some of your decisions based on that information, as opposed to fucking like just going balls to the wall from minute one.
But it's not even about being strong. It's just about understanding the limitations of your champion, or understanding how a skirmish would work with your champion.
If a that just screams inexperience of the game to me.
Yeah, like if a skirmish happens, like if you come
inexperience of the game.
No, 100%. Unless you can make it work, and then you're just better than some people, which is so depressing.
I'm going to tell every jungler out there right now that's low-tier jungler, like if you consider yourself low-tier, you can decide if that's platinum, you can decide if that's bronze. I'll let you, the listener, decide if you feel that yourself
low-tier
is low-tier.
I'm low-tier and I'm plat, so there you go.
There you go. If you want to feel that way, if you feel that you're a good player, then don't listen to my advice. But my advice is don't be so gun-shy. If you're coming bottom lane because someone asked you to, or if you feel that's the right decision, be ready to go in at the moment's notice. And I think it becomes like, kind of like you said, it's an experience at the game. Understanding that like Jarvan is going to dive me under the tower, you should be walking toward that bottom lane and be at least standing there. You could literally be standing at the tower with me, and that could deter.
That comes back to the whole presence conversation that we've had, and just being in a place to show people that you exist can be enough of a deterrent, especially if you have those gun-shy people maybe on the other team too. I mean, that's a two-way street in this regard. But
you know, it was funny that you brought up Whale and I called him an outlier, because it's really that's not the case. He's really aggressive, but he knows what he's doing. And I got to duo lane with him a couple times, and he narrates every action that he's taking, and like he'll be like, is this available, is that available, yeah, okay, let's just go, we can go, we can totally do that.
It's actually,
I don't even know if he realizes that he's processing everything that way, but he is.
It's really interesting that you bring that up, because we were talking about it and he was saying how one of the main reasons that he dislikes playing bot right now is because he can't control, and I think this is just more of a support conversation than anything else, he can't control or like know what the support is thinking when he wants to do the things he wants to do.
Sure.
And because of that, it holds him back a bit from doing the things that he would usually do, which is why he ends up playing mid. Because it's the same thing.
I should duo with Whale then. Like, it's never going to happen, but I should do that just because it's like, yeah, okay, you want to go? I'm my pleasure. I'm happy to do this. You're telling me everything that you're going to do, and I can start like making my own decisions from there because I know what you're going to do now. That is the reality of bot lane, is you think you have a read on somebody and what they're going to do, but you're always guessing and you're always hoping that you've read a little bit of their mind, or that they're, you know, they're on the same wavelength as you. But if you guys can't get on that same wavelength, you just
in conversations,
you find yourself hoping laning ends as quickly
with
as possible.
Him too, where things have gone either even or he's slightly behind or whatever, his whole like, and again, this might just be another symptom of what's going on with Marksman at the moment, but all he wants to do forever is just farm. Like,
yeah.
And I know that's something that marksmen always want to do, but he just seems to have such a priority on like, no, just delay out the game everywhere else and let me do this thing. And then we'll hit this point at like 36 minutes where we can just end things. Because he decided to queue up his ADC and he can't do the things that he's usually doing in mid.
So. I think you're trying too hard to get in Whale's head, because I can't fucking beat that guy at all.
I love that dude. He
filled in for us mid once.
He can
once
be such
and was
a
like,
dickhead sometimes.
He goes, I'm done. Sean and him get together like, we're just done. We're just going.
Yeah,
we don't want to play this anymore.
Let's either win or lose, and we won. So whatever.
Right. Well, that. Pretty, I think that brings us to the very end of any and all discussion we could have with all this. I don't want to jump into the other items. I specifically tried to stay away from the other items in the show so that we could have more to talk about on a Wednesday. But overall, I like this show. And guys, if you're listening, which obviously you are because you made it this far, right? Let us know. We really want to know if you like or dislike a specific show. Like, if something really resonates with you, email us, feedback@trinityforcepodcast.com.
If you want us to talk about something more specifically as well, if it's some tangent that you just really, really liked, fucking email us. You know what? Tweet Adam directly and send him dick pics, because he'd really
appreciate. Don't do that. None of those, please. No. Zero.
Children.
Absolutely zero of those.
Like we got a lot of feedback on the last episode, and that was great. I don't know that we were going to talk about all the AD carry stuff again, just because in my mind it was like, well, we talked about it the one time, you know, what do you do until Riot brings it up? But it, clearly it was on people's minds, and they wanted more in-depth conversation about it, and we're happy to do it. But we can't read your mind, so we're relying on you to tell us, you know, what you want to hear.
Fair enough. Guys, please, feedback at trinityforcepodcast.com. Email us. Let us know what you think about the episodes. You can email us. You can go in. If you go into Discord, by the way, discord.trinityforcenetwork.com. If you go into Discord, tag us if you're going to leave feedback, because
yeah,
I
please,
don't jump
if, in. If you're trying, if you just drop something in one of the channels and I'm not tagged on it, chances are because of the amount of stuff that goes on in there.
There's so many messages.
I probably won't see it. So if you're looking to reach out to one of us.
Sorry, I think you can actually tag T-Force proper, T-Force podcast in there. I think they allow you to tag groups. So if you want everybody to see it, just tag the group and let us know. Additionally, we have a subreddit, reddit.com/r/T-Force Network. It's been pretty dull over the last 9 days, so jump in there. If you want to make a discussion, like this is really good. If you want to start a discussion somewhere about something we talked about or you disagree or whatever it may be, jump in there. We will have a very polite discussion with you until you piss me off, and then I tell you to fuck off, and I tag
you
forever.
Until you piss Adam off to the point where he ends up texting me at 6:30 in the morning to go check out some Reddit thread on the subreddit.
The only reason I text you that early is I know you're awake, Sean.
I know, because I'm fucking awake at 5 a.m. I hate everything.
Oh, I love you, Sean. I love the fact that I could text you at 6 o'clock.
Well, I mean, I've texted you before 6 a.m. before, so you know what? It goes both ways.
You don't get a reply from me until I get out of my shower, though. Sorry about your luck.
So you're at work and have had breakfast.
No. I'll reply to you. I'll reply to you between 6 and 7.
You know what's crazy
in
that, though? Fucking, I get MMA texts from Wiz earlier than that. So
Jesus Christ.
Yeah, he sends me shit when he's on the way to the gym. Drives me crazy.
All right, guys. That's the Trinity Force podcast for this week. Thank you so much for listening. Thank you for all your support. We guys, blah, blah. I'm having a problem talking.
We fucking love you. That's all the goddamn matters.
We fucking love you guys. We love you all. Thank you so much for listening, guys. We will see you all on Wednesday with more discussion. Peace.
Kisses.
Goodbye.